shows a paradigm transformation that happens once you realize how much the new can bring us if we set our senses alert, if we give the right steps, and with a bit of open-minded scent. Innovations that will make our life better and easier often struggle with difficulties, outdated regulations, restrictive policies, and one-direction governance schemes. And all of those previously mentioned being very local and very limited. If you allow me to introduce you the virtuous cycle or the virtuous loop, starting with sound and responsible actions and governance, the existence of ubiquitous innovative technology availability that is clear these days, the people knowledge rise and citizen science means co-creation available in all fields will lead to behavioral change and virtuous habits, and specifically in mobility, this is absolutely needed. So, summarizing, if we really want to meet a better, seamless, and multimodal mobility in our cities, we need to prepare the field with sound policies and regulations and responsibly sharing governance with citizens and other stakeholders. Our group here deals with this relevant issue. You are very, very welcome to participate. Thank you very much for this time, and feel free to contact me. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Jesus. And I think the main item of your presentation is also about is what we also saw in the beginning and the first two, especially the first two, three speakers, that innovation is one thing, but when you need to go for implementation, you also need policies, regulation to work on. Thank you very much, Jesus. Then we go to the last speaker, and then I will go to the Q&A. So I see some questions popping up, but everyone, if you have some questions, please feel free to add them in the chat of this session. And there, Eleonora is already there. Eleonora Venensi works for Chava Digital Media, and she will inform us about finding synergies between stakeholders to create the new best practices for smart walking and cycling.
Yes, thank you very much. Can you hear me well?
Yes, I can hear you pretty well. Yeah,
excellent. Thank you. Good morning to all. So let me introduce the working group on last night, smart walking and cycling of NMS. The philosophy of this working group is to put stakeholders together in order to create synergies or in order to share best practices on these important issues, smart walking and cycling. We have two dynamics. We want two dynamics for this work group. First, create projects and present them to Horizon Europe or call from of the Green Deal, for example. And the second thing, we would like to follow a portfolio of remarkable projects on these topics. So then we will try to synergize crossovers and at the end of the road to have a list of best practices on these topics. We don't want to reinvent the wheel. We know that a lot of things have already been done. Police has done a remarkable job on these best practices. But we have this feeling that things are moving very fast. And to what I've heard from all the previous speakers, remarkable projects are running. And it would be great if you could have it all together and draw the lessons, draw the conclusions of it through sort of a white papers on best practices in smart walking and cycling. So more practically, what we do in this work group is to have partners, stakeholders from academia, the public sector, the industry, governmental stakeholders together and share their intent to try something new, to implement use case on the streets. We want to implement use case and drive collaborative innovation projects on smart walking and cycling. So the questions that will be addressed will be how, for example, what make people walk or cycle, how to guide them specifically, which technologies could be explored, which use could be made, how to educate people to walk and cycle. This is the societal dimension of it, which is so important. And is it possible to change the attitude in certain cities, countries, and what about the governance? So, you know, it's all mixed. So a key point is the collaboration between these stakeholders and also the other work groups. Smart parking, excellent governance. So the baseline is to always have an open mind and be always very aware of what the other work groups are doing. And we will learn from it. So we look forward to the next NMS physical session to see all the partners and stakeholders that would be on board and to start launching projects for 2021 calls for proposals. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Eleonora. You can stay here, and I would like to invite the speakers of the second round to join for the Q&A session. And that were Anna, this is Daniela, Theo, and Jesus. Yes, there you are. I see a question in the chat session from Anna to Jesus. And Anna is asking, what specific action do you undertake in your group?
Yes, I was trying to write it down because we are doing many things. So in order to summarize and to get the bullet points for what we are doing or what we try to do, because this is ongoing on processing. So first step is to analyze, collect, and share best practices and initiatives for the specific topics that we are dealing with. So this includes what we are regulations, policies, and governance. To be able to shape a sort of common narrative on what backs and makes those cases of better mobility successful. We know that not all the cities are equal, not all the cities have the same background and the same reality. So cultural issues are also happening and also part of the plot. So with all that, we hope to be able to find a way in which these opportunities will be given to other cities and they can start their own routes with the background of what others have been able to do. And we are also interested in developing methodologies and tools to be able to spread the good news to those cities. So that's in a nutshell what we are aiming to. Thank you.
Tamara. Yeah, unmute, Tamara.
Sorry, I was on mute. I had some background noise, so I did mute myself. Sorry. Thank you very much, Jesus. Anna, was that answering your question?
Yes, actually, because when I was listening to Jesus Quintana's presentation, I was thinking that your group works quite similarly as IMED. So by one side, you are building a kind of white paper as we did, collecting all the data which there in order to raise awareness about the topic. And by the other side, you also work on specific developments in terms of or technical topics. So that I wanted to check that and see how Nissan could fit there.
Yeah, exactly. We should merge. So I think the point is not reinventing the wheel. So using both works, it will be lovely in order to finally produce a better outcome. So let's contact.
Okay, perfect. So you see connections coming in here. So that's really good to see. I also see a question from Marlin. Maybe Marlin, could you join us again? And of course, for everyone in the session, if you have some questions for the first speakers, that's also still possible.
Hi.
Yes, hello, Marlin. Hi. There was a question if you could share your innovation strategy in the Dropbox. Edwin shared the link with Dropbox. I'm not sure, but
I think I will email Edwin. And it will be shared there. But unfortunately, the long version is only in Swedish. Yeah. So if you want to have a shorter English version, I can send it to you. But then please contact me in person. Okay?
Yeah. Okay. We will do. And what can be shared will be shared by Edwin. Yeah. Okay. Well, I think I don't see any questions in the Dropbox we didn't address yet or were answered already in the chat. Then I will go to the poll. And then the poll of this session is, the first question was, how would you describe ourselves? That's still a bit more than 70% is from government. So I think this is good because the Polish government is for a governmental organization. So that is, I think, good to hear. The second question was, who should take the lead and first ownership, in your opinion, in the transformation to sustainable urban mobility and the wider market uptake of smart and green mobility solutions? There we have several options, and also one big winner. Some do think the government, some do think the triple helix, but the most majority, 75%, thinks the larger ecosystem of all stakeholders, including governments, industry, researchers, with citizens in the forefront of design and development, deployment. Well, yeah, I think also, and I think, we're working hard on that, but we have a step to go there, especially in including the citizens in what we do. Do you agree with me, everyone who is now in the session, or do you think something else? Well, I think everyone is knocking here, so I think we know what to do to make innovations really implemented in the cities and the regions. Well, then we have another question, and that's one: do you consider yourself an early adopter, early majority, late majority, or laggard in adopting new mobility solutions? And of course, you can interpret that this question differently. Do you think this about yourself, or do you think this about your organization? So this is also a question for discussion. But when I look up on the results, I see it is 50-50 between early adopter and early majority. So even when we are here and all professionals interested, not everyone sees itself as an early adopter, but at least we think we are early there. And I think it's the challenge to also have our organizations, especially the governments, being early adopters of early majority. And everyone who still now is a speaker in the session, if you want to react, please do it. Feel free.
I agree.
Well, I'd be curious to know who is the late majority person. There's one person that has said it's a late majority, and it's quite, I think it's quite interesting, because as we are all working in this field of innovation, it's funny that, and it happens in many occasions, that even if you advocate for innovation, you don't apply it to yourself. It happens to me in many other fields as well.
Yeah, okay. Good question, Anna. And if the person who did fill in that wants to make him or herself public, please leave a reaction in the chat. Daniela.
Yeah, I would just wanted to add that when we look at this for runner ecosystems, we see that the role of the city as an innovator is very prominent. So you see that the city can break through competition between private partners, could work towards incentives, and those are really, there's the leverage. So I think the role of the city as an innovator is interesting to discuss.
Okay, yeah, I think it's definitely interesting, but I also wonder, because I'm also working for a city, and for a single city, it's sometimes a bit difficult to break through all the private companies, huh?
Yeah. So what you see is that incentives help. What we see in last mile solutions for freight is that they tend to work together better if the city kind of have the incentive to have time slots and to make use of space, reuse of space for private partners if they work together as an incentive. So, and then they are less in competition with each other. So we see that reoccurring a lot, yeah.
Okay. Now I see that the one who was thinking it was a late doctor did make herself public. Well, Isabel, do you want to say something about that by yourself, or shall I give a reaction? Oh, there's Isabel.
Yeah.
Sorry, well, putting you on the stage.
Of course, like I'm a bit ashamed. Well, no. No, but maybe I'm critical because I do see that there are so many options, but I still choose the regular ways of traveling. And of course, I've written down there aren't that many options in my small town where I live. So I just have my car in front of my house. And of course, I want it differently, but there's so many habits. So I confess. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Isabel, I see. I said I was an early adopter because I think my city is really into innovation. But the reason you give for your reaction is the same for me. I live in a small city, and it took me 45 minutes to come to a train station. So that makes that. For work-related items, I choose, most of the time the car. So, so it's not so easy to do in real life. Of course, for shorter trips, I try to do bike and walking, but it's difficult. And there was not just one person, there were two persons, because we also got a reaction from someone in the audience, and that's also people are more careful about, for instance, during COVID and in sharing mobility. And I think this is also something we have to work on in the next years to, when we can say we want mobility transition, not everyone is able to bike, walk, or it's maybe a bit inefficient, so definitely innovation comes also in there. Then I see also some questions popping in, and while I'm looking at the chat, we have a question for you, Eleonora. And that is the question from Anna, and it was, I was wondering to know how to find balance between smart walking, micro mobility solutions, and cars. I could imagine there are some distance that can't be done walking. So what's the right balance?
Oh, I like this question. It's so challenging. And I think that the first answer is, well, it depends. It depends on several parameters. And this is clearly the type of topics we want to address. It depends on who you are, where you are, where you go, where you are from, and what the city is offering you on the street, and what technologies are on the street available as well. So it's really a combination, a mix of a lot of different things, technologies, mindset, and a level of innovation the city wants to dive in. So it's also what I like in this question as well is that it underlines the fact that smart walking and cycling, it's a journey. So you can switch the type of equipment you use. You can walk, you change. Anyway, but it's a journey. And what will make you, what will trigger the decision? It can be a relevant information at certain specific points on the street that indicates the distance between some points of interest. And then you can decide which type of mobility you want to go through that distance. A greater awareness, proper information, and to think differently this type of communication. How to make this decision going? Well, it remains an open question to me, but it's a very good one and typically the one we should find some answers to in this working group. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Eleonora. I see a question from Theo to all participants, and this is also one for cities. So maybe Malin, could you also join the stage and maybe answer the question for all of the participants in the session? And that is, Theo asking us, we are looking for examples of how to compensate the loss of a parking income for cities and new business model to monetize the curb. Do you have experience in that? In Helmond, we need to start working on that, but maybe you're a bit in front of us. I'm not sure either.
I know it is a difficult question. And from the city perspective, we see two things. One strategy that we have is that we want parking to be inside buildings, like in the garage. And the parking company owns a lot of these kind of garage or buildings. And there are private companies as well. So avoiding the curbs, get them into the garage, stimulates another kind of financial transition in the city, but towards the company instead of the administration. We also see that when using the app, paying by the app, so the city administration has a parking app, increase the willingness to pay, so we earn more money than before we had the app, because then we need to control much more, which costs money, and the willingness to pay was lower. But the real answer to your question, how can we transform this, I think we don't really know. I think that's also a question about national taxes when it comes to combustion engines being transformed into electric cars. How can we gain the taxes in the transport system in the future?
Okay, thank you very much, Malin.
Thank you very much, Malin. Please stay in the session because we have a question for all the panelists. And the question is, smart governance should not refer to smart integration of different policies or different sector visions. The definition of a smart city, from my point of view, is the one it becomes a facilitator of the dialogue between all types of stakeholders, institutional, private, citizens, etc. Smart governance in a city is beyond cycling and walking. Anyone who wants to react? Yes, Anna, please go.
Thank you for this question, because I wanted to further elaborate on this, actually. We have a very good example that illustrates what we really think in IMED about smart governance, and it's the mobility areas in Milan, that it's a part of the Sharing Cities project. Maybe most of you know this project because it's one of the Lighthouse Smart Cities project that has been funded by the European Commission. So one of the pilots is happening in Milan, and it's a good example of smart governance because by one side, the city of Milan have been collaborating since the very beginning with all the stakeholders in the consortium in order to adapt the solution to the needs of the citizens. But the solution is not just about electric vehicles, for instance. It's about multimodality nodes. That's why they call it mobility areas, because the idea is that they allow the seamless transition from a mobility mode to another one. So you have electromobility, which is really very well supported there, because you have the chargers, you have good places for the e-logistics and last mile delivery people to charge and also uncharge their goods, etc. But then you have the connection with the train station, you have the bike sharing system, etc. The idea and the message I wanted to give here is that by one side, smart governance is about collaborating with all the stakeholders, but then it's also about multimodality. That's my point. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Anna. Jesus?
Yeah, I feel that clearly what is needed a facilitator role in the administrative body, a path or give a way to this kind of better interaction between stakeholders. There are two terms that are very interesting when we are discussing this, is generosity and responsibility. So both things are needed. On one side, you need generosity to be able to think that others can play a significant role in defining the right governance among the different stakeholders. And the other point is responsibility. So once you are there to plan or to decide how to proceed, there's also a responsibility implicitly. And that is the role that usually the administrator takes. But in this case, you are sharing also that part. So yes, generosity to be able to define new ways of interacting in the city, because there is not one solution that fits for all. And also the responsibility comes to the table with the same strength in order to make that new mobility capacities or new mobility ways durable in the future. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Jesus. Daniela, I think you also would like to share your vision.
Besides collaboration and the great examples already Jesus gave, it's also about decision making and then multi-stakeholder decision making, which is quite difficult, and also to see how that kind of develops long term towards impact, and that then data comes in. So these things should really be monitored quite closely. What is the impact of a certain decision? What I now see is a lot, because I'm in the work group freight, that a lot of the decisions made in mobility are not integrated with freight, where you could have these integration fairly seamlessly also. So it's not only a mobility or city logistics, but it's also the integration with the vital nodes, and not to have, and again, the siloing of city logistics and logistics for freight and transport. So there's I think a broader thing where it comes to cities and the rural aspects we already talked about, but also multi-decision making on a more regional level and broader than the city alone.
Yes, thank you, Daniela. I think it's sometimes difficult to do it as a city alone, so you need to work together in the region, and I think it's really it's important but not always easy. So what I now will do is I will go to the chat session or to the poll session and see the answers there. I see not everyone in this session did answer the poll question, so please go there and then we can go through the questions and answers. There is the question, which new mobility solutions are you using frequently in real life? And I now have to answer the question before I can see the outcome. And what I see here is that 18% of the persons in this session use shared micro-mobility, like electric step bikes and scooters. Well, there are also some who are happy in driving their car alone. Someone is saying, one person is, I don't own a car and use public transport in combination with cycling and or walking. And 50% is saying I own and drive a car and occasionally use public transport and or cycling or walking. So yeah, a lot of us still use their own car. So also for us, I think we need to work on the transition to new mobility services. So still some, at least with our early adopters or early majority, still work to do. Another question in the poll, and the last one is, did you learn or hear anything new today? Or did you listen to anyone you want to meet bilaterally for further conversation? Well, yeah, I see here is that happily, oh yes, everyone did learn something new today. And 60% says I learned and heard something new today, and 40% is saying I want to talk to someone and will take action. Okay, if you have problems to connect with the person you want to have action in, then please leave a message in the chat and we will or send an email to the email address in the chat, and that email address is from Edwin, and then we will try to connect you. And for me also, I also did learn some new things today, although I knew know most of the speakers already. And it makes me aware that collaboration is really important, not only with the usual suspects as stakeholders, but also with yeah, with the citizens. This is also some conclusion we draw from an internal smart mobility workshop back at home. And also that implementation doesn't come easy. You need to do something for that, for like say working procedures, or I also learned from working principles for Marlin, and I also heard about the 6-month actions plan. So definitely things I will go on working after this session. So I think now it's time for Edwin to do a wrap up of this session. So Edwin, could you please join us?
Yes, I'm back again, I hope.
Yeah. Yes.
Good.
Edwin.
There is too much to say. I have only 5 minutes, but I could talk about this for 1 hour, of course. It was really interesting again. And of course, I want to have an applause for all speakers. So please applause at home for all speakers. But while watching you and listening to you, I realized also that the last speakers were all doing voluntary work. I mean, both the IMET as the NMS working groups, we are all doing this as volunteers. This is not a project. We're all doing that in combination with our regular work. And so that means extra applause from my perspective, because I find it impressive that however, you don't have a project plan and not anyone from the commission yelling at you that they want result, you're still doing it. And listening to the story from Daniel and from Theo and from Eleanor and Jesus, things are happening. What I like, especially for example, what Theo is doing this together with all kind of other stakeholders outside our NMS, and really make things happen, and Daniel too. So that's important. That, I mean, we are struggling as NMS and IMET how to bring this further. And after all this time, you see really seeing concrete results, and it's like real life. It's like innovation in real life. Sometimes nothing happens for a long time, and then suddenly, poof, there is something. So that's nice, and that's why I really look forward to continue working with all of you in the years to come. Then. I also realize, and that goes for all the stories, that we are dealing with complexity, of course. Why can't we just make a plan and implement it and then be ready? No, this transformation to new mobility is extremely complex. Perhaps I'm not telling you anything new, but it's good to realize that. The complexity, which has three dimensions. First of all, the enormous amount of stakeholders. Well, we can just say it's a triple helix, but that is not true. It's much more than a triple helix, of course. You have already a quadruple helix when you involve the end users, and And then some participants said, why didn't you involve real estate, huh? So, or insurance companies? So there are so many more stakeholders, and every time we develop, we discover new stakeholders that we did not involve. The second dimension of the complexity is, of course, the enormous amount of barriers, huh? And most of them are not even technical. Right? There are all kinds of barriers in culture and policy and legislation and standardization and whatever. So that is what we are working on, dealing with all those barriers that are also interacting all the time. And then for me also the most interesting and fascinating dimension is that of the enormous dynamics in time. It is what we learn today is really obsolete tomorrow. Things are developing so fast, not only technically, there are all kinds of new technical opportunities all the time, but also in the learning by doing, things happen, people change, society changes. I mean, look at COVID now. This gives a large boost this year in innovation also. So these three dimensions of complexity are all the time interacting, and we're all the time dealing with that. It is that makes it fun also, and that is probably why all of you are doing this kind of work, because we like this complexity, and if it was easy, we all would have gone something else. So that's how I want to finish my wrap-up, talking too long already, and give the floor back to Tamara and you.
Well, thank you very much, Edwin, for your wrap-up. And I also see the audience in the chat says this, that your wrap-up was pretty great, Edwin. So, well done. Before we close the session, I would like to give the word to Bernadette Bergsma. Bernadette, can you join us?
Yes.
There's Bernadette.
I'm here. Yes. Thank you. Thanks, Tamara. Thanks, Edwin, and all for the very inspiring insights. I don't know, you have a slide of what I wanted to show here.
Yes, we have a slide. Claudia, can you put up the last slide? Yes, there is coming.
Yes, many thanks. Just a few words about EIT Urban Mobility. So we are this year actually having our first annual conference of EIT Urban Mobility, which is our flagship event. This is taking place on 9 and 10 of December, so next week. And we want to ask you to join us for this great event, because what we're doing is bringing together experts on urban mobility from not only in Europe but also globally, high-level speakers from the European Commission and other organizations working on urban mobility. We have our partners there, stakeholders, but we invite you all to take part in these discussions and follow us there. We also provide some good networking opportunities for you to get more insights into what we do, into the programs of EIT Urban Mobility, some inspiring presentations of projects that have been taking place this year, also about COVID-19, of course, and the impact it has. So all very relevant and current happenings. And so I would like to invite you hereby to join us for this. You can still register. Just go to the website eitumsummit2020.eu. And I look very much forward to seeing you all there. So this was what I wanted to highlight here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bernadette. And I hope also to see everyone at the EIT Summit. And now it's time to close down this session. And Edwin did already thank everyone involved, all the speakers. And I would like to thank Edwin and Isabel for organizing this session, because without them, it would not be possible for me to host this session. So thank you very much, Edwin and Isabel. And then I will close the session, and I hope to see you in other sessions during this Polis Congress or in the EIT Urban Mobility Summit in 2 weeks. Bye.